Erskine, Deputy Assistant Secretary of Commerce for the U.S. Department of Commerce, the EPA. Chris Rice, who's the Management Analyst with the Department of Commerce Economic Development Administration. And we're also going to hear from Mayor Copeland, the Mayor of Vidalia, Louisiana. One of the themes that has been coming out of this week is that New Orleans is not just back from the greatest man-made disaster in modern American history. By many, many measures, we're doing better than we have in decades. Old industries like trade are at record levels. New industries like technology, we're the fastest growing in the country, are doing remarkably well. And I think most significantly, people are voting with their feet. Young people, workers in their prime, everybody is coming back to Louisiana, Greater New Orleans, and to New Orleans. So it's all extremely, extremely promising. What I would say is that we would not be here if not for the federal support, the support of the Economic Development Administration, the support of the Delta Regional Authority. And it's a story that needs to get out there, but their combination of top-down federal support, which has then gone and underpinned the local expertise, is why we have gotten the results that we have. And so I'm thrilled that we have the EPA and the DRA here with us today, so we can recognize your contributions and tell everybody about them. But speaking of importance and catalytic impact, I think that Mayor Mitch Landrieu rises to the very top of that list. I don't think it's any secret why the city of New Orleans started doing so well just about in 2010. I think that's
because the Saints won the Super Bowl.
I don't know if that's correlation or causation, but we'll take it. But it is it's my honor and pleasure now to introduce the mayor of New Orleans, one of the most important people in what's been called the turnaround story of our lifetimes, Mayor Mitch Landrieu. Mayor?
Thank you, Mayor.
Y'all don't remember that? I mean, I got elected mayor, nobody knew about it. The Saints won the next day, and it was like crazy. That was a catalytic effect. Anyway, it's great to see you. Michael, thank you so much for your leadership. Of course, to Chris Masingill, who is our federal co-chairman of the Delta Regional Authority, to Ken Hyatt, who is representing the president and the secretary, the undersecretary for international trade for the United States Department of Commerce, Matt Erskine, who's a Deputy Assistant Secretary for Economic Development for the U.S. Department of Commerce. And my dear friend from one of the great cities in America is Vidalia. And Vidalia, we have Hiram Copeland, who's been a dear friend for a long time. You know, this week is designed to do three very specific things. One of them is to never forget the lives that were lost and the tremendous trauma that we suffered as a people. We lost 1,800. Of our brothers and sisters, our mothers and fathers, our aunts and uncles, our cousins, and in some instances, our children, literally from the hands of parents who watched them be dragged away by the floodwaters. That is forever seared in our soul, and that's not something that is ever going to go away. And this week is designed not as a celebration, but really as a commemoration for them, and to give us a minute to reflect back on where we were, not only during the storm, but where we were before the storm. The second thing that we want to do this week is to be a grateful city, because we would not be here were it not for the love, the caring of people across the world, across America, and our neighbors themselves. We literally helped each other out of the water. People from 32 states housed us, fed us, clothed us, and then came not only to our aid, but found new friends here and have become partners with us. And we have found a new way of not building the city back the way she was, because she wasn't perfect before the storm, and it took us a lot of years to get where we were the night before the storm. But to actually take a moment and do the courageous thing, take the time, do the hard work to build the city back the way we always dreamed she could be. Just yesterday, I broke ground on cut the ribbon on Dunbar School. This is one of 37 brand new, state-of-the-art, 21st century learning spaces for our children. Nobody in America has got nicer schools than this, because our kids deserve a world-class education. And that's just one example. Yesterday, we opened the doors on the University Medical Center, which, as you know, is immediately adjacent to the new Veterans Administration Hospital, so that we can provide great care to our wounded warriors and our veterans. Those two hospitals combined are going to create an economic engine that will be second to none that this city has ever seen. It will be as catalytic as the Superdome was, but the city in the years that it was built. And for those of you that are old enough to remember, it was built on a railroad yard. And Poitras Street literally did not exist as we know it. The city actually was three blocks to the other side, bordered on both sides of Canal Street. And that changed the future of the city, and these medical centers will as well. Just those two projects are emblematic of the way that we have rebuilt the city in the last 10 years, and has done something, as Michael has said, something transformational. You know, 10 years ago, we were 17 feet underwater, and in some instances, we were really dead in the water. A lot of folks said we shouldn't come back. A lot of folks said we couldn't come back. A lot of folks said we didn't have it within ourselves to go from where we were to anywhere. And of course, that has turned out to be exactly not true, because there was no doubt in my mind and no doubt in anybody's mind who's from the city of New Orleans that we were going to get back up, and then we were coming back, because come hell or high water, and we had both, this city was going to stand itself back up again. So who could have thought that 10 years later, you would hear things like, we're the fastest growing city in America, U.S. Census, facts, Fordham Institute, America's best city for school reform, Inc. Magazine, coolest startup city in America, Kauffman Foundation, 20 hottest startup hubs in America, Forbes, number one for brain gain. Nobody's ever said that about us ever in the years that we've been here, and they're saying about it now. And the reason it's important to put a stake in the ground now is because if we could have done that after the worst man-made disaster in history, that we could do anything. And of course, it's forced us to think about ourselves differently, because before the storm, we were very parochial. A lot of us talked about regional cooperation. A lot of us talked about where we actually sat geographically in the international scheme of things. But now the Delta Regional Authority, the United States government, really understands the power that we can bring together when we kind of convene ourselves as a regional dynamo. And so that is why the Delta Regional Authority, that's connecting the Delta Regional to the international marketplace, is really important. Katrina actually reminded the world that we were here. And the world had to acknowledge how important we are to this nation's national security and economic security. We produce most of the oil and gas. Those wetlands protect those pipelines. International trade comes in and out of our port. We clothe and feed the rest of the country. If you want to see the country shut down economically, shut down the river. We actually did that for a little while after Katrina, and I think it cost us $500 million a day. Farmers are not getting this stuff back and forth from Iowa if this river is closed. The Northeast is not getting textiles, et cetera, et cetera. And so you know the importance of it. So it's critically important that we come together today, and as Michael said, drill down on the new way. And the new way is a partnership between the federal government, the state government, the local regional authorities, and the cities. It's a partnership with the private sector and the not-for-profit sector. It's a partnership because we're all in this together. It requires a robust and thoughtful and focused, efficient federal government. It requires a city being able to receive it. It requires public-private partnerships with GNO Inc. to make it work. And when we're all together, we produce something great. When we're all apart, we don't produce much of anything. And so that is what we are here today to talk about. And I just want to come as mayor of the city of New Orleans, as a grateful city, to thank all of you for the work that you have done. The partnership with the Obama administration has been spectacular. You know that we're going to receive three presidents in our wonderful city. In the next 3 days, President Obama is going to hit the ground around 12:30, 1 o'clock. President Bush will be here tomorrow, and President Clinton will be here on Saturday. Now, the people in New Orleans thought the world had forgotten about us. They can put that away, because the whole world is going to have their eyes on the city of New Orleans, because for the first time in our history, we have become this nation's most immediate laboratory for innovation and change. The rest of the world is actually looking to us now to lead, and the only question is whether or not we're going to step up to the plate and get it done. We made a lot of progress. We should be proud of it. We've got a long, long, long way to go. But now we have the tools to actually give the people of New Orleans the ability to build generational wealth like we've never seen before. And I know with the announcement today and so many others that we're going to hear about in the next couple of days, we're going to get there. So thank you very much. God bless you guys, and thank you for your help.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you again for your vision and for your leadership. Speaking of leadership, leadership does matter. And our next guest, the federal co-chairman of the Delta Regional Authority, Chris Masingill, since I met him a few years ago, he made it clear that his vision and his energy was going to take his organization, the DRA, and actually grow its impact, grow its influence, and really change the course of history where it operates. And so we're thrilled to have you here with us today, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. Michael, again, thank you very much. I appreciate the introduction, and I appreciate your leadership
and engagement, not only with us this week, but really the development of a new model for economic development. GNOE, quite frankly, is a model for not only the region, but the country. How you look at new economic development strategies, how you pull in stakeholders, how you engage with your federal partners in doing economic development a little differently. And the mayor is absolutely right about several things. One is, nobody has forgotten about New Orleans. New Orleans actually belongs to the world now. And we're so glad that New Orleans is our anchor in the Delta region, economically, culturally. Many of the aspects and the wonderful attributes and the assets of the Delta region is anchored right here in this area and in this region. And I'm so thankful for the mayor to give us an opportunity to partner with him. He's a real leader, and this area is lucky to have Mayor Landrieu at the helm during these very, very important times. It's really exciting, too, because when he talks about a model, the impact that New Orleans and this region has on the world, it's pretty significant. And so for us at the Delta Regional Authority, 8 states, 252 counties and parishes, almost 10 million people, 200,000 square miles. And when you look at the economics of how our region really operates, that river is truly the lifeblood of our people, our communities, and our business. And so it's very appropriate for the Delta Regional Authority to be engaged with what's happening, to help be a platform where we can take the models that we're learning for the recovery, for the development, for the strategies that have been put in place, and to share that with the rest of the region and, quite frankly, the rest of the country. And this is a new day for doing business. We do business differently under President Obama's administration when it comes to federal partnerships. We break down the silos. We make sure that we're responsive, that we're accountable, we're transparent, and we're on the ground. It's not a one-shot wonder. We're here for the long haul, just like this recovery has been here in New Orleans and the entire region. And that's why when we work together in partnerships, it really is about looking ahead to the future. It's about the impact that we're having up and down the river. Because quite frankly, we need this area to be successful. It is important not only to the region economically, but for the country. And Michael, you said it, I think, very well this morning before the press conference started. What's happening here really is impacting the entire world. The world is looking at New Orleans and how you're doing business now. And we're here to do two things. One is that we're here to announce a partnership with EDA, and we work well with EDA. We have for a long time. DRA's only been around since 2000. And in the course of that, we've been able to leverage over $2.3 billion into economic development investments, particularly when it comes to infrastructure, transportation, workforce training and education, small business development, and entrepreneurship. And when we look at what the next stage of those partnerships are, we look to some of our critical partners. And in this case, it's the Economic Development Administration. It's the Department of Commerce. When you look at the impact that EDA has had in this country, in fact, they're celebrating their 50th year in existence. Some of our strongest partners, particularly in rural America, has been EDA and the investments that they've made in public works and infrastructure. And I'm so glad for the country we have them. But one of the things that Matt and I have been working on for a while is making sure that we take these new models in economic development and we share those with rural leaders, both urban and rural communities working together in new ways in economic development. One of the most incredible things that's coming out of this partnership and what's happening here is the impact of what happens in the urban core and its relationship to their rural communities. We are tied together. We may play football on Friday nights, but when we get past that, we recognize that the jobs are shared between each other. Healthcare is shared. Infrastructure is shared. And so one of the things that we're doing today that we're announcing this partnership for economic development training for chief local elected officials in new ways. They are a part of the economic development process. They must be at the table. And along with that is that we now know when you are a chief local elected official, I tell you, that is the toughest job in government. When you're a local mayor or your local county judge or county executive or whatever you may be called in your area, making sure that you're including economic development into your daily work, but now with a completely more important focus on resiliency. But not just the traditional sense of resiliency. resiliency in the aspect of what does it look like from the lens of business and industry? What does it look like to integrate resiliency with economic development strategies? We need to make sure we're sharing the models of success here with our mayors, our practitioners, our community leaders, and our business leaders on the ground. So we're rolling out today this partnership in training and capacity building for economic development for chief local elected officials and resiliency training, economic resiliency and recovery training for our local elected officials with EDA. Number two is that we recognize when we look at the future economic impact of the region, particularly in the rural Delta region, and expanding small businesses, because we recognize small businesses in our part of the world is the heart of our economy. We know that the greatest potential for growth is increasing their capacity to go abroad, to make sure that they can sell their goods internationally, to expand that impact. Louisiana is a great example for that. New Orleans in this region is a phenomenal model of what's happening to expand export and international trade. We want to take those success strategies and share those. We want businesses to make sure they know that this has been an administration and a strategy that has had enormous successes increasing international trade and export. Louisiana is number one in the country. New Orleans is number one for export growth potential. We want the small business of Delta region and rural America to take advantage of that. There's resources, there's technical assistance, there's greater strategies that are in play to do that. So in partnership with the Department of Commerce, again, particularly in this case, the Commercial Service and ITA, we're going to do that. We're going to provide greater focus and access to technical assistance, resources, and training for small businesses to expand their capacity to tap in to those incredible export markets, because the greatest potential for growth for small businesses is in export trade. We know small businesses make more money when they export. We know they actually hire more employees, and the employees actually make more money and earn a higher living when they have greater export trade opportunities. And so that's what we're doing today, and I'm so excited about this partnership with the Department of Commerce. It is very impactful, and we need to do more. And to talk a little bit more about that, I'd like to introduce my friend representing the Economic Development Administration, Secretary Matt Erskine. He's no stranger to economic development. He's been doing this actually for a while. He's worked for a governor at the state level and at the local level, and now he's been able to serve as the Assistant Secretary and now as the Deputy Assistant Secretary, our good friend, a Chief Economic Developer for the United States, Matt Erskine.
Good morning. It's so nice to be back in New Orleans, and I'm honored to be here with you today to help commemorate the 10th anniversary of Katrina, but also to celebrate the economic growth in this region and the resiliency of the people of New Orleans. And it's going to be my honor and pleasure to make some new and exciting announcements this morning about the U.S. Department of Commerce and the U.S. Economic Development Administration's continuing commitment to this region and the state of Louisiana. But first, I want to thank my friend, Chris Masingill, Chairman Masingill from DRA, for his leadership, and also his entire team for the important work they're doing for communities like New Orleans and across the Delta region to rebuild and recover and to build resiliency. Your efforts have been instrumental to the growth of the Delta region. I want to thank Michael Hecht, in Greater New Orleans for hosting us here, for his leadership, and for the great work that they do. Mayor Landrieu, of course, it's a pleasure to be with him again, and I applaud and admire his leadership and the commitment to rebuilding this great city. The city and the region have made amazing strides in their recovery. And Mayor Copeland, good to be with you again. Thank you for all you do and for your leadership. The U.S. Economic Development Administration and the Delta Regional Authority are partnering like never before, as Chris mentioned, to serve the needs of the economically challenged communities across the nation and certainly here in the state of Louisiana. By working closely with community leaders to create economic opportunity and jobs, EDA and DRA play a vital role in our nation's economic development agenda. As we come together today and throughout the week to commemorate and reflect on the lessons learned from the tragedy of Hurricane Katrina, it's also important for us to recognize the great progress that has been made as well as the work that remains ahead. And for 50 years, EDA has invested in communities like New Orleans to support, nurture, and catalyze innovation and economic activity, leading to new jobs and sustainable economic growth. At EDA, we approach our federal economic development investment in a place-based, bottom-up way, investing in local people and in local organizations who know their communities the best. And at EDA, we seek to advance the model of economic development that provides investment and assistance in an integrated way along the full spectrum of local and regional needs. At the end of the day, it's about building capacity, local and regional capacity, as I think we've seen here in Greater New Orleans. The ultimate goal is to help communities and regions become agile and more resilient in the face of the changing economic environments. And we do this through a broad and flexible portfolio that addresses basic infrastructure, technology infrastructure, planning, partnership building, economic adjustment assistance, and other technical assistance. And importantly, we've also integrated a proactive approach to resilience in our comprehensive economic development strategy guidelines. These are guidelines that help communities formulate effective, long-term, inclusive plans for economic growth. Importantly, that has been done here, and we have helped Greater New Orleans with that effort. EDA has long-standing roots in this region and has played an important role in supporting its bottom-up, locally driven strategies to develop and strengthen the region's economic ecosystem. Since Hurricane Katrina, EDA has provided 42 grants to the Greater New Orleans region, totaling more than $32 million to support resilient ecosystems and to foster innovation economies. And this includes six grant investments to Greater New Orleans over the past 8 years, Greater New Orleans, Inc. And today, I am pleased to announce several new EDA grants that will help serve the economic development needs of this region and the state of Louisiana. First, I'm happy to announce that we are awarding a $1.15 million grant to the Capital Region Planning Commission to support renovations to create a new Capital Region Operations and Resource Center that will serve as Disaster Response and Resiliency Center for the region, as well as fellow coastal planning districts requiring an emergency evacuation shelter and assistance. Second, we're awarding a $400,000 grant to the Idea Village to continue to strengthen New Orleans' reputation and brand and true position as an entrepreneurial hub, not only of the South, but of the country. And the funding will assist with the expansion of Idea Village's entrepreneur season to provide increased technical assistance to New Orleans businesses through seminars, targeted business assistance, and facilitating entrepreneurs' access to capital. And third, I am pleased to announce that we are making a $250,000 grant in La Place, Louisiana, to support a strategic plan and marketing study to determine the potential impact of building a new container terminal at the Port of South Louisiana. As I think we all know, the current port infrastructure is nearing capacity, and a container terminal would increase the amount of cargo the port can process, helping the South Louisiana region increase exports and its competitiveness in the global economy, which is especially important given the new developments with the Panama Canal. And later this afternoon, I'll be making another special announcement for the additional benefit of New Orleans. So today, as we commemorate the 10th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, we celebrate the strength of this region and we demonstrate our continued commitment and efforts to support its recovery and success. As Chairman Masingill mentioned earlier, our partnership with the Delta Regional Authority will offer a series of economic development training workshops for community regions and elected officials here and across the Delta region. The intensive in-person training course is designed to help the public and elected officials, local elected officials working on the ground, develop strategies to support their regions, as well as provide the practical tools and resources that local leaders need to be more effective and efficient at disaster resiliency efforts. So in closing, let me reiterate, on behalf of the U.S. Department of Commerce and the U.S. Economic Development Administration, our commitment and our partnership with you remain strong to the City of New Orleans, to the region, and to the state. And we look forward to our continuing partnership, applying our collective fortitude and energy to the critical work ahead. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Secretary. It is not hyperbole to say that that GNO Inc. would not be here today, certainly not in this form, if not for your support. So thank you. And I think what's important to note about the support of the EDA and the DRA is that it's not only large, and 32, really, I think 43 million if you combine them together, but it's strategic. It's done with intentionality. They're investing in strategies and organizations that they think are going to pay dividends and be catalytic. But most importantly, it's sustained. It's not a single hit. And so with that really makes an enormous difference. So thank you. And now it's my pleasure to introduce Greg Thompson, who's the acting director of the New Orleans U.S. Export Assistance Center. Economic development is exports. If you're not exporting it, you're not actually creating economic development. You're moving the eggs around the plate. We want new eggs. So to talk about getting more and better eggs, Greg, we're happy to have you up here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good morning. It's a tough group to follow. Ken Hyatt, our Deputy Undersecretary, was supposed to be here with you all this morning. Ken had a family emergency, and so he asked me to step in late yesterday. I'm really excited to be here, and thank you to the panelists for putting this together and letting us be a part of it. I'm thrilled that today, in a region with a thriving tourism industry, entrepreneurial culture, and high-performing ports, we'll be focusing on international trade as a driver of economic development, business growth, and well-paying jobs. We at the U.S. Department of Commerce's International Trade Administration are proud to partner with DRA, provide international workshops through our U.S. Commercial Service, U.S. Export Assistance Centers. And we commend the Delta Regional Authority for their commitment to make it easier for small and rural businesses to participate in trade events where international deals are being made. Some numbers that might be of interest. Since 2005, New Orleans goods exports have increased 6 times over, reaching a record of $34.9 billion in 2014, accounting for just under 70% of the state of Louisiana export overall. The New Orleans metro area is currently the 8th largest good exporting area in the United States. New Orleans district is the largest port system in the U.S. by export tonnage. This port district also handles 50% of all of the U.S. grain exports annually and is the country's second largest port based on petroleum and petrochemicals handled. Tourism remains the single largest source of tax revenue in the city and plays a vital role in the economy. Each year, approximately 500,000 visitors attend Mardi Gras. Estimates of the direct and indirect impact of Mardi Gras top $320 million annually. A lot of money. And here's where it's really all comes together. Exports from Louisiana support 170,000 U.S. jobs. Foreign-owned companies employ more than 58,000 people in the state. We at the International Trade Administration, with our partner agencies, including EDA and DRA, as well as the local partners in New Orleans, want to ensure more Louisiana companies succeed internationally because exporting companies are more competitive and more likely to weather economic downturn. The data shows, as sort of mentioned to earlier, exporting companies grow faster, they hire more employees, and they pay up to 18% higher wages than their counterpart. The International Trade Administration is the premier resource for American companies competing in the global marketplace. At ITA, we work to strengthen the global competitiveness of U.S. industry, promote U.S. exports and investment into the United States, and ensure fair trade through the enforcement of U.S. trade laws and agreements. We also offer the expertise needed to connect U.S. businesses of all sizes with export opportunities that will increase profitability and support job growth here. Our services include trade counseling, business matchmaking, market intelligence, and commercial diplomacy. To help local companies do business internationally, we have international trade specialists in more than 100 U.S. cities. For more than 30 years, the New Orleans U.S. Export Assistance Center has served the southeast region of Louisiana. It is critical that these resources are not a secret. That is why we are thrilled to be working with the Delta Regional Authority to expand access to trade assistance and awareness of international opportunities throughout the Delta. ITA began working closely with the DRA following the President's announcement of Made in Rural America Export and Investment Initiative in February 2015. In summer of that year, in partnership with the White House Rural Council, the DRA hosted the largest of five major summits held across the country, which brought together businesses and experts to share best practices for exporting goods and services in rural areas. U.S. Commerce Secretary Penny Pritzker was a keynote speaker at the Memphis Forum. As is evident, trade and investment are a crucial part of the community's economic growth and stability. New Orleans has been smart about its recovery post-Katrina. The city has made the effort to work with partners, including DRA and ITA, to educate its business community on the importance of expanding goods and services to overseas markets. We look forward to continuing our great work with you and seeing the next 10 years of economic growth and development. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. As somebody said before, that mayor, being mayor is a critical job. I think that being mayor is probably the best and the worst job that you can have in politics, because you're CEO of your city, but it's really hard to go shopping. So, Mayor Constant, thank you for what you've done. And Gretna, thanks again to Mayor Landrieu for what he's done. And now it's our honor and pleasure to hear from the Honorable Mayor Hiram Copeland from the city of Vidalia, Louisiana. Mayor.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
First of all, I want to say it's an honor and privilege to be part of such an outstanding group of gentlemen this morning. I feel in awe of the Secretary and everyone being involved, Secretary Masingill. But for myself, on behalf of our co-chairs, Mayor Buell of Dubuque, Iowa, and Mayor A.C. Wharton of Memphis, Tennessee, I want to thank the Chairman Masingill for inviting the Mississippi River City and Town Initiative to be a part of this announcement. Both Mayor Landrieu and I are members of MCRTI, along with 66 other mayors spread over 10 states, the entire length of the Mississippi River. I want to also specifically acknowledge Mayor Belinda Constant, Gretna, Louisiana, who will represent our association during the panel discussion later this morning. As devastating as Hurricane Katrina was on our region, the sustained impact of climate change since 2005 have proven to be just as distressing. From 2005 to 2015, the Mississippi River has sustained successive 100, 200, and 500-year flood events, and even a 50-year drought. Hurricane Isaac and the most tornadic activity ever recorded, this makes our region both acute and chronic climate impact zone that requires solutions on a larger scale. That is why I joined MCRTI, and the mayor is realizing that we have to join both our voices and our capacity to build opportunities for our cities. Cities along the Mississippi River collectively generate a gross municipal product of almost $500 billion annually. The southern stem of the Mississippi generates $151.7 billion directly in revenue each and every year, and employs over 585,000. Top three economic sectors along the river by both employment and revenues are manufacturing, tourism, and agriculture. According to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, waterways and ports in Louisiana alone support 281,590 jobs and contribute $47.7 billion to our state's economy. If we're going to train business owners on how to take their product and services to global market and support current global export businesses, then we have to ensure that infrastructure is in place to make increased exports possible. Let me share with you specifically how mayors all the way to Minnesota are helping us here in the Delta. 26% of commodities traveling on the lower Mississippi River are exports. Almost none of the 30 million, this is an amazing figure to me, almost none of the 30 million containers that were imported into the United States in 2014 moved on the Mississippi River. If we can return container movement to the Mississippi, then we will provide increased exports capacity to our region. Indeed, adding 50 million people to the United States by 2050 will create a cargo demand that is almost double than what we are moving today. That there is only one freight medium in the country that has capacity like this, our inland waterway system. Delta Regional Authority has been one of our closest partners in this effort. DRA helping and the mayors of the Mississippi River have formed a working group that includes Walmart Stores Incorporated, Home Depot, the Port of New Orleans, Ingram Barge, Inland River Port and Terminal Association, and others. Small businesses comprise most of the economic capacity of our cities, and mayors themselves are elected entrepreneurs because we have to innovate to keep our city competitive. We understand this in a small community like Vidalia, Louisiana. This is why my city is building a $39 million port facility, and I want to share some of those details with you. And Secretary, Assistant Secretary was mentioned some numbers previously. I want to thank Chairman Masingill for working with us on that port, and our, and also our multi-million dollar industrial park facility. And as Assistant Secretary said a few moments ago, and I don't like to mention these figures because people say, where did you get all the money? And a lot of that money comes from the NBA. I don't want to say the amount because they'll be after you fussing at you. But we're very proud of you. You can understand we're only 5,000 people in the city, town of Vidalia, Louisiana, and that's how important it was to our economic region. Can you imagine the impact it's going to have on a community that basically is running double-digit unemployment right now, and the economy has been slow in the years past, but we're getting ready to move forward, I can tell you that. Conventional approaches to building an economy will no longer work. Advanced regionalism must be pursued as should best practices that are adapted to rapidly changing conditions and resilient to ever-increasing stresses. It must be understood that our region has not had a free ride since Katrina. We've had to endure extreme events in the following years leading up to date, but these challenges are not keeping us down. They are making our region stronger and our approach multilateral. Never before have mayors come together around this natural resource we call the Mississippi River, America's original Main Street. Last night I had the opportunity of a lifetime. They messed up on my room at my hotel, and they had to put me in a large suite. I'm telling you, the suite was larger than my house. But overlooking the best view you could ever have was the Mississippi River and where the river is in a bend. You'll see the barge traffic coming up and down. Never have I seen so much barge traffic up and down our river. It was amazing to me, a little country boy compared to Louisiana, 3,000, 4,000 people there to come and see something like this. But what's so amazing is to be part of such an organization that represents 66 municipalities up and down the Mississippi River. There's over 100-something municipalities that are located on the river. Our goal is to recruit each and every one of those municipalities to be a part of the Mississippi River City Town Initiative. I want to emphasize, we wouldn't be possible if not for Chairman Masingill and for the EDA working with us also. Each and every one have a good day today, and thank you for coming.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And as I was watching him, I reminded that my grandmother is from Natchez, right across the stream from you there. And you know, it's been a week of reflection, and I think one of the things that has come back to me in such a recurring way this week is the degree of teamwork and unanimity of purpose that we've had in southern Louisiana. This is a place that kind of defined, that created the term parochial probably out of our parishes years ago, but now we work together
without question, it's become second language, kind of a physical memory. I just wanted to thank everybody, all of our leaders and the elected officials and the business community for doing that. So that's going to conclude our press conference portion of the event now. I think we're now going to go into our panel discussion on export. And so we're going to do a couple of things. We're going to ask our panelists to come up to the front now with us. They're going to be Secretary Erskine from Department of Commerce. Director Thompson is going to be up here as well. Mayor Constant, it's your chance to change seats. And you can come sit right here, please. Donna Lem from the Mallory Group. Come up, Donna. Hank, that's my friend Hank Torbert.
He's here.
Okay, Hank is in the building. Thank you. And then Paul Zimmerman, Director of Operations from the Port of New Orleans. So, like, inside of your way.
Okay.
We are going to start with a brief presentation that's going to be delivered by our Executive Vice President, Robin Barnes, kind of giving some context on what's happened in Louisiana and southern Louisiana over the past 10 years, called Better Than Back, that tells a story of an economy that, thanks to, in large part, our federal support, has not just come back from Hurricane Katrina and Rita Ike Isaac. Sounds like a terrible singing group. better than ever before. And I think it's just fascinating to look at this in kind of longitudinal context. And I apologize. I actually had a crazy situation to a panel. I have to lead. Imagine that. I was in a panel. that I'm going to have to step over to across the street at the Hyatt. So I wanted just to, again, thank our guests from the DRA, from EDA, from Commerce, from the Export Department, Assistance Center, and thank all of our guests for being here, and thank everybody for the past 10 years and all that you've done. So, Robin, I'll turn it over to you.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now that we've asked our panelists to come to the front, we may awkwardly ask you to turn around and face the screen, or if you wish to sit in the first row here.
I cannot do that.
As we're doing that. So, the point of this presentation is really to set the stage. We have a fabulous, I think, great discussion. But what we wanted to do was really put in the context of what the region, how the region is doing right now, what progress is made, what are the things that we're still working on. So the way we talk about it is better than back. And it's important to note that before the storm, Greater New Orleans was underperforming. Not only in the South, but in the entire nation. Right there down at the bottom compared to our colleagues in the South and Asia. Hurricane Katrina, we know, was the most devastating man-made disaster in our history. Lives were lost, unbelievable tragedy, still feeling attacks today. Took the opportunity of the incredible federal investment that we and really figured out how to invest in a way that reduces economic development. Not everyone thought we could do that. All read the papers, the headlines were not good. As the mayor talked about it, it was a big question about whether or not it was going to be worth it. This was sort of an iconic moment in September in 2006. Steve Gleason, the hero of that day, he was the hero of a very different day. But this was a full, very symbolic turnaround moment for our region and really helped inspire us forward. I'm actually not a sports fan. I wasn't born a sports fan, but when this happened, it really turned me around and really realized that, you know, communities can be motivated by actions like this. So this is what then started happening. Natural gas, the low cost of natural gas started fueling a boom. We're seeing investment in our state, and particularly in our region, around advanced manufacturing. Traded at record levels. I'm not going to dwell on that because that really is the topic of conversation for the rest of the day. But here you have it. Advanced manufacturing is more than thriving, and significant activity is happening. And things up in space. Just so cool. Work down here that is game-changing and has been so historically. We've managed to invest in the sector around this. We have an incredible tax credit that's helped fuel that growth, and you can see some of the impacts that that has had here with companies that have either expanded or started up here. Destination healthcare is an incredible opportunity. It is taking advantage of the healthcare, of the biomedical corridor, and turning it into economic development. And what we mean by that is really investing in entrepreneurship and innovation as we're moving forward. Emerging environmental is a new sector that we have developed that is really looking at how do we take advantage of the fact that we have environmental challenges. Those are here to stay. They're not going anywhere. How do we turn that into economic opportunity? How do we create jobs by addressing these challenges? And the proof is in the pudding. We found out after Hurricane Sandy, because Louisiana companies sell their logos there, actually took on Hurricane Sandy work, and to the tune of $200 million in federal prime contracts. So that is really proof that we honed expertise after our disaster, and now we're able to help others after their disasters, meaning that we're really a hub for this such activity. Entrepreneurship is surging. That has been a big theme this week in the media. There were some announcements made today about further investment in entrepreneurship. Tourism is at record levels, and our new airport is only going to enhance that. And now the rankings have changed. Now we are number one on the list of top investment markets. Some of the qualitative assessments are showing that CEOs are looking very favorably now on New Orleans. Rankings continue to improve, and we did not have these rankings before Katrina. They are here. And people are voting with their feet. So not only are people moving here, but people are staying here. So now we have more college-degreed individuals than we did before the storm. And again, a lot of those are sort of people are no longer leaving. We don't have the folks going off to college and staying away. Now people like Ashley come home. So this is why we say we're better than back. We're not done. There's a lot of work to do. But we've made terrific headway. And now within the context of this growing economy, we're going to be better able to also address some of the other issues and problems that are still. So we hope that you have a terrific conversation today and that you kind of dig into what is our opportunity in terms of international trade and such. And that I'm going to turn it back over to Chairman.
I'm going to ask the panelists to come back up and to join me. We'll dive into this. We're a little bit behind schedule, so hopefully we'll catch up just a little bit. Robin, thank you very much for framework and all the great work you've done in helping us this week and your continued partnership with us and Michael as well. Well, I think Michael did a great job of actually framing this up for us, and then Mayor Copeland, your perspective and the engagement with the Mississippi City Schools and Towns Initiative is very important. And we recognize that this international trade piece is a critical element that we want others from around the region to really understand. To have an understanding that this is a real strategy, regardless of your size, that you can put in play in your economic development framework. And so this conversation today is very important and very timely. The successes that's coming after what's happening with the recovery here in New Orleans and this impact of the international trade is something that we're seeing that we need to share with others. And so with that, we've had an opportunity to get a sense of who everybody is, but we're going to kind of change the format a little bit. I know that the staff's going to be mad at me a little bit, but because of the sake of time, we're just going to kind of dive into this a little bit. And what I'd like to do real quickly is just do a quick round of introductions, and Hank, I'll ask you to start. Just tell us again who you are and who you represent, and just a quick thumbnail sketch of your background and where you're coming from in terms of this issue, and then we'll go, and then I've got a couple of questions, and then I want you to be thinking of some questions as it relates to the subject matter, because we want to also engage with you to make sure we're getting this information shared with everybody. But before we do that real quickly, I want to introduce another partner that I noticed that's here with us today,
And Michael, I'm going to call on you here. Michael Ricks, he's the stage director for SBA, another great partner of DRA and EDA. And Michael, thank you for coming and being here today. Thank you very much for your partnership. So, Hank, I'll turn it over to you.
Sure. Morning, everybody.
Morning.
My background is pretty simple. I've been 20 years in private equity across several sectors, including transportation, industrials, energy, media, et cetera. Former JP Morgan investment banker. I'm a partner and founder of Arl McCall Capital Partners, which is based here. It's a leveraged buyout shop, as well as specialty situations, which means real estate. And one thing I think I bring to the table is I've actually been and lived and worked in numerous markets that have benefited from import-export, Africa, Asia, spent a lot of time in Latin America. So I have a keen view from a private equity or private investment standpoint.
Again, I'm Greg Thompson with the U.S. Department of Commerce. Specifically, I'm the acting director for our Export Assistance Center located in Customs House. I would urge all of you to reach out to us as you look into exporting dollars. Thank you for letting me be here.
Good morning again. Matt Erskine. I'm Deputy Assistant Secretary for Economic Development at the U.S. Department of Commerce. And I, too, would recommend that you go to EDA.gov for more information on our resources and the work that we do to support local communities.
I'm Belinda Constant. I'm Mayor, City of Gretna, but today I'm here as a member of the Mississippi River Cities and Towns Initiative, invited here by Chairman Masingill.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Donna Lim, Valerie Alexander, headquarters in Memphis, and today actually celebrating birthday. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things that we've done. We're very centered and focused on agriculture, moving our exports through the Port of New Orleans, but also talking about some of the things, the challenges that we have, the competitive challenges that we have as we buy for this trade through this port, and competing actually with neighboring Gulf ports as well.
Good morning, I'm Paul Zimmerman, Director of Operations for the Port of New Orleans. I'm responsible for day-to-day activities with all the ships that come and go here to the port. Also, maintenance, those six big container cranes, blue cranes, you can see out the window over there, a fire department, Homeland Security, a police department, port maintenance. How many of you know, we talked a little bit about it this morning, there are all sorts of facts and figures, but I'm going to leave you with one kind of summarizing fact here. From the mouth of the Mississippi River to the port of Baton Rouge, about 200 ship miles. The river, as you know, is very curvy, not a straight line, so it's about 200 nautical miles. That is the largest port complex in the world in terms of tonnage. Now, we have a lot of firsts around this area. We have a lot of attributes, but I'm just wondering how many of you know that statistic. And I think it's probably appropriate that we add the Port of Vidalia in that as well. So we'll now say those six ports comprise the largest port complex in the world. Hope that you take that back.
Great. Thank you all very much. Well, let's, and Paul, I think you're a great one with that you just mentioned to kick us off. We recognize all the great stuff that's coming out of these covers, but seeing that there's lots of stories, we know that there's still a lot of work to do. And some folks have really put on the table that the export and trade piece is a critical element of that future. So what do we do next as it relates to the international trade and the port, the largest in the world? How do we move forward now?
There's a term of the, since Katrina, there's a new word that's kind of like my buzzword, and that's collaborative. What we are doing here today, and I'll use the term collaborative communication, it is just so critical and essential that not only do we collaborate amongst ourselves, an individual entity, but collectively, not only through GNO Inc., through state economic development, through our federal partners, through federal, state, local economic development, through individual organizations, it is just so essential that we take a collaborative approach to economic development, and in particular in the maritime industry. And we have seen how that has actually benefited us. Port of New Orleans, in particular, we've had the best 5 years in port's history over the last 5 years. Last year was our largest year in terms of tonnage. Before that was a record-breaking year. Since Katrina, we had made great strides. And let me share with you, everybody has their own Katrina stories, and there's two little small stories I want to share with you. About four nights after the storm, I was on Bourbon Street, foot vehicle. I was like maybe in the 500 block of Bourbon Street. I got out of the car, turned the engine off. There was not a light. There was not a sound. There was not a person. There was not a dog barking. There was nothing. Total stillness on Bourbon Street. The most surreal moment of my life. I remember thinking, will Bourbon Street, will the city come back? Let me fast forward a few more days after that. We had, we were very fortunate, about 8 days, 9 days after the storm, we actually worked our first shift. Really a monumental effort for all parties concerned. The ship was coming in that night. French Quarter was basically filled with military, and everybody knows that, so police, military, and so forth. There's no business at all yet. We were living on a ship at Fulton Avenue, one of those big gray maritime ships that you see out there. And every morning we would drive to the French Quarter to go check the port seat. One morning I was driving through, and I kept thinking about, you know, the Bourbon Street episode. Will the city ever come back? There was a bar room, and I don't remember, it was on Frenchman Street somewhere. I saw a guy unloading a van with some cases of Corona beer. And I thought to myself, you know, isn't this just perfect? This is New Orleans. Of course the city will come back, and of course the first piece of business I see is a bar room. So I stopped for a second. You know, we were working long hours back then. It was a tough time, everybody knows that story. He was unloading some case of Corona beer, and I pulled up next to him, and I had my Ford vehicle. I said, hey, man, is it possible? Can I get a case of beer from you? I was thinking, how great would that be to go pack to our ship that night, share this with some people, just something, get a little break. And he kind of looked at me and goes, yeah, $100. Then he looked at me again, he goes, you could really use this case. All right, so he gave me a case of Corona beer. And I think what I'm about to say, you know, turn play it forward, this might be the first case of it. That afternoon, I got a nice chest. I found some ice, so I had in the back of my car, unbeknownst to anybody, I had a case of Corona beer ice in there. Well, the ship was coming in that night, the first ship. We did not have electricity to that particular part of the port just yet. The energy crew was out there. We had some of our maintenance guys. Everybody was working on getting electricity out to get lights to work the ship. Well, the ship was due in about 6 o'clock that evening. About 3 o'clock, still didn't have lights. Crews were out there. They had been working tirelessly. Everybody was just exhausted. The NTG crew and our crew were about to just say, look, we just can't get it. Call it off. Well, let me ask you, hey, guys, come on over. So I got about 6 or 7 guys sitting around there. I said, you guys want to sit down and have a nice cold beer? Oh, yeah, man, let's do that. So there, my thoughts of bringing the beer back to the ship that night to share with my workers kind of fell out the window. But the important message here is that the energy crew, our crew, everybody kind of sat around for a minute, drank their beer, gathered themselves, went back to work. We got the electricity up and running. Finally, right before the ship came, cargo was unloaded, and as they say, the rest is history. But it harkens back to the term I used earlier, collaborative. You know, if we didn't take it, that guy with the case of beer at the bar wasn't willing to share that, if I wasn't willing to share it with the guys from NTP and our guys, you know, you get the message. So it is a collaborative approach. What needs to be done in the maritime industry, we need to take that approach to get going. And the best 5 years of port industry, but things like today, will help develop the port industry, not only for the war on the ground, but for the ground.
Thank you.
John, how do we expand? Back on what Paul's talking about, I am in the maritime business. He's right. In collaboration, when we look at our industry, we're talking about ports, we're talking about our ocean carriers, we're talking about our trucking community, rail community, and it's all of these pieces that make us have a successful supply chain to service our customers. And so it's absolutely critical that, one, we have customers. That's why we need you. But we need to continue to understand that together we can get this done. done. Now, I gotta tell you, guys, part of the issue, too, is that carrier base. We look at international trade, and I spoke earlier just for a second about how competitive it is out there. How do we bring those goods and that trade through the Port of New Orleans? We need the carrier base. This morning, and we're very familiar with the portfolio of services that we have in New Orleans. Very heavy traffic to North Europe, very heavy traffic to Latin America and the Caribbean. But also as we look to Asia, we need services. We need one capacity. And so we look, as I look to the future, I look to the port to continue their effort, and we will do our part to continue to service this community and service this community well. But we absolutely need the mission carrier base, and the word was used this morning, and that is capacity to service the trade.
Now, Mayor, you've got a different twist on it. You're right across the way, but you're representing a pretty bigger perspective. So from MRCTS perspective, how do we expand the trade piece? What do we do next? And how are we taking what we're learning here?
Well, I think as a smaller city, we need to work towards our infrastructure investments so that we can complement all aspects of our regional vision. We need to be in a place that we can attract economic development opportunities and be ready, as we talked about earlier with the press conference, the collaborative approach of return of a region, not just one city, but a region across the Mississippi. And, you know, from the city of Gretna's perspective, I'm 4.5 square miles big with only about 18,000 people. So goes New Orleans, so goes Gretna. And so it's so evident in listening to everybody today, I think that we all realize sitting in this room that the success of our city is hugely dependent on the city of New Orleans and the port and the region and all aspects. So what we are doing today is really capitalizing on where we fit into this big picture, be in the space that we are. And I think what we're doing now is concentrating on housing stock and looking at a vibrant community with quality of life, from a quality of life perspective, and how we can impact the commercial realization of what MRCTI is trying to really collaborate with the port and others in order to bring a different perspective to the success. And in a small community like us, we want to realize the importance and, again, work with the city of New Orleans and realize what the Mississippi River means, not to, just to the Port of New Orleans, but what the reality is for a city such as the city of Gretna or the city of Vidalia, absent its port opportunity. Small communities like ours, we want to continue to work not just on a local level, but to be a voice at a regional level, because everyone in this room brings a little bit of the pie to the table, and so does the city of Gretna as it relates to the city of New Orleans. You know, we pride ourselves as being the capital city of Jefferson Parish, and we pride ourselves as being the bedroom community of the city of New Orleans. And in saying that, that's not just a little focus, but it's a reality of a bigger region. And I think knowing what we possess is most important. And I think being able to bring that to a table such as this is important as well for us to sit down. And that's why I'm excited about the opportunities for local mayors with the Department of Commerce and what you see as being important for the boots on the ground people who, that is true, can't go to the grocery store. I drive my husband to the grocery store. My assistant's in the back. He can attest to that. He saw that yesterday. So he can get out and grocery shop while I sit and wait for him, because it would be about a two-hour grocery trip for me. So I think being having a seat at the table and being able to focus on the reality of what we bring to the table is most important to all of us. Right. And thank you for Mississippi River, the Mississippi River Cities and Towns Initiative. It's been an incredible resource. I'm happy to be a part of that. I agree with Mayor Copeland. Every mayor on the Mississippi should be have a seat at this table and be a voice and realize the reality of what we at the tip of the boot means to the rest of the world.
Thank you, Mayor.
Sure.
Very, very well said. Mr. Secretary, we've talked about this before, and I think the mayor actually laid some good groundwork. You're making investments all over the country. And as we think about where does this region need to be,
how do we expand that economic opportunity through trade pieces, that infrastructure piece? From your perspective, how does EDA see this issue?
Thank you, Chris. I think I'd just start by saying that, you know, from day one, President Obama made trade and exports a priority, recognizing the importance that it plays really across our economy. And I think we've, you know, Mayor Copeland talked about this, you talked about this during the press conference in terms of export jobs pay better. It supports small business with upwards of more than 80% of the world's consumers outside of the U.S. Most of our businesses only export to one country, vast majority. And when you look at the potential not only to get more companies exporting to more countries, but more companies, especially small companies, exporting, the benefit both, again, to higher wages, better jobs, and the overall economic growth across the supply chain is tremendous. And Secretary Pritzker at the Department of Commerce from day one has also made export trade and international trade a priority. So with that as context, EDA, we as I said earlier, we invest in the capacity of local communities to improve the conditions for, in what we're talking about right now, better trade, better exports, expanded exports. That can usually and most importantly starts with proper planning. So we help communities, as we have here in Louisiana and in the greater New Orleans region, with that comprehensive economic development planning around where are the gaps. Here's where we want to be in terms of our capacity to support our businesses and to support increasing trade. And then when those gaps are identified, we work with the communities in terms of infrastructure, like our announcement today, going back to the planning piece with the Port of South Louisiana, in terms of they know that with the expansion of the Panama Canal, that just represents tremendous potential to a port that's already out of capacity. And so through this planning study that EDA is funding, it will help them develop the long-term plan for the new container facility, again, to take advantage of the opportunities from the expansion of the Panama Canal. And Mayor, we were together at the U.S. Department of Transportation a few months back talking about increasing container traffic on the river with Mayor Copeland. I think an important meeting with the MCTI and how EDA can support. Again, we don't directly invest in companies. We invest in the communities and in their capacity to support companies and private sector activity. And so we're going to continue to partner in that way, again, from planning to the infrastructure investment to the other kinds of technical assistance that we provide through our programs, again, to really boost the capacity for better and more expanded export trade.
Perfect. Director Thompson, I think that's a good lead-in.
I was going to say,
boots on the ground. You're literally the one that connects the dots, right, on this issue. But what's next?
And I was going to thank Matt, because, I mean, obviously, the Export Assistance Centers really agree with the EDA and have similar viewpoint on what's a winning strategy. We would like to see international trade be part of that winning strategy for economic development for all, everyone involved. I think we're hearing that across the panel, really. More and more regions are assessing their industries and strengths, assets, and fostering coordination among service providers. And this morning at breakfast, we got a great presentation. You know, we really hit home with that, what's going on. I think leveraging everybody's resources, synergies that all of us bring to the table, reaching out to the Export Assistance Center that's closest to you. Crystal Mills is here with us. There's Crystal in the back, my colleague in our office here in New Orleans. And also the District Export Councils. If you're not familiar with those are experts that are already in the export field, whether they be actual exporters or service providers, and they're basically volunteering their time to other businesses here in the area to help get you up to speed on exporting. So we partner with the private sector to make sure that we're getting the word out on how to do things. So again, I think it's a similar message, collaboration, and going, playing to everyone's strengths.
Great, thank you very much. Hank, I see you nodding your head over there, being the money and finance guy. Kind of wrap this thing up for us as it relates to, from your perspective, how do we increase what Greg's talking about?
Well, I mean, to me, it's very simple. We all realize that there's a strong correlation between economic growth and trade in the United States. We've seen that historically. But one of the key things that all of us need to focus on, and as we say, corroborate and work together, is what I call strategic sourcing. And beginning to open up and look at other markets, we have long-standing trade relationships with Europe, as you know, Latin America, but there are other markets that we can focus on. For instance, Charleston is trying to focus on Africa to some extent. You also have Cuba, which represents $5.9 billion of annual trade or export trade with the United States per year. You also have other parts of Latin America. So as we move forward, my hope is that we, A, strategically source. What I specifically mean by that is something that Cargill does. Cargill says they'll find a farmer in Arkansas who grows a particular type of grain and match that person with somebody who needs to buy that somewhere else. And that's similar to what you guys do. But it's also, as we think about our trade missions and all these other things that are out there, we have to focus on finding buyers for our small, medium, and large businesses that are based here. And the more we do that, the more all of us as part of the ecosystem do that, the greater you'll see trade. Because smaller businesses need to sell their products. And as I look at it, there's a tremendous opportunity for people in agriculture, value-added manufacturing, and so on, as we begin to look at some of these other markets.
Thank you very much. You mentioned Arkansas. My home state, and I noticed one of our leading economic developers, you talk about the diversity in the region and having that regional perspective. John Edwards, representing Helena, West Helena Port, is here. John, good to see you, and thanks for representing that part of the region. I think Hank also touched on something that would be good to have the next question lead to. And we talk about some of the barriers, we talk about some of the challenges of really moving this issue of expanding trade and exports. And it always comes back to infrastructure. Not only physical infrastructure, but the ecosystem infrastructure, and how does this really come into play with how we move forward. So I'd like to throw that out to the panel. And Paul, I'm sure you've probably got some strong feelings about infrastructure and infrastructure investing as it relates to the port, particularly as we start talking about this container on barge. A huge potential, but also it's significant. And it's not going to be easy. And we're not quite there yet. And how do we deal with that issue? And I'll open that up. Whoever wants to tackle that first, Paul, why don't you start?
Infrastructure development. Maritime industry is extremely expensive. How do you build things on the bar, especially on the environment? It's just very, very, almost cost prohibitive. We have a plan to develop our container terminal. Currently, we handle about 400, we have the capacity to handle a little 400,000 containers per year. We have plans to almost double that to nearly a million containers per year. Fortunate part, we're about $400 million short developing that project. Definitely have the plans, we have the wherewithal, and know how to do it. It's $2 short. Now, as a public body, we are finding ourselves in kind of a unique situation. We do not receive any tax money. Our friends over in Houston have the ability to tax in Harris County. Our friends in Florida, Georgia, Alabama, received fairly significant state funds to help develop their port system. Unfortunately, here in Louisiana, we do not receive much federal funding or state funding, so as a result, we as a public port authority self-sustaining. Having built our container terminal, our cruise terminal, we find ourselves with not that much bonding capacity left. So where do we go to get money to build this infrastructure that we all know we need? I was kind of hoping Matt would add that $400 million. We certainly welcome you back in a couple of weeks to come back with that.
That's a big check.
But we now find ourselves in, you know, the buzz
partnership. We find ourselves now talking to a private investment firm, the large steamship line. The problem is those people want a pretty significant return on their investment. Public agents invest in something in all sorts of return on investment criteria, and quite frankly, it's not a whole lot of return on. A lot of it public is for the public good. So we generate a small, very modest return on our investment. But the private sector wants something a little more significant than 12%. So the point is, we are now finding it pretty challenging to find funding to develop these issues that we have on the table. Is the answer federal government, state government? The answer port authority? Is the answer private sector? The answer to that is yes. I go back to the collaborative approach. We have made great strides in growing the maritime industry in the lower Mississippi River, and particularly in New Orleans. Every one of our market segments has grown significantly. We're now handling over 1 million passengers a year in the cruise industry. Think about that. We have two state-of-the-art cruise terminals now. We're embarking on a third one down on Portland Avenue. We can do great things at the largest refrigerated warehouse, maritime warehouse in the country, kind of grown by leaps and bounds. And we've done a great job of doing that over the last 10 years, but can we afford not to continue that growth? So where I'm leading to now is we need to find some creative ways of finding the money necessary for investment. Additional ways of port authorities funding their own investment is kind of falling by the wayside. So going back to the often used term here this morning, collaborative approach, we do need to take a collaborative approach to all stakeholders, not just the port authority's job to build these facilities. It's everybody's job, everybody benefits. So while we may not have all of the answers, certainly look Matt, to perhaps find a way to help us all benefit and do the great building that we had planned for. So,
but funding aside, I couldn't even afford Starbucks. Funding aside, I want to give
you... Yeah, Matt, could you bring coffee?
I want to give you an example of why infrastructure is so important. Several months ago, we had a West Coast strike, well, West Coast labor, call it that. That lasted 9 months. I told you guys that we're in the business of agriculture. We are. We're in the containerized business of agriculture. We had thousands and thousands of containers that had to move to market. Our largest market is the natural gateway for much of these goods, especially out of Memphis. The double stack train through the West Coast, thousands of goods sitting. We waited 30 days, in some cases 60 days. I'm a native New Orleanian. We have a very large staff here. We collaborate on a daily basis with our forwarding community, our warehouse. Trying to get capacity out of New Orleans was nearly impossible. And that's when infrastructure becomes paramount, not just to solve immediate band-aid solution, but to give our shippers options to move their goods. So you solve the funding issue, we'll bring you the freight.
If you bring us more freight, maybe we can help solve the funding
issue. Well, Donna, to that point, one of the first things I wrote down when I was asked to speak on the panel is the focus on more storage, because with all of these markets, you require that, especially when there's a backup in the supply chain. Especially as we begin to look at, like I said, other markets. Cuba, for instance, doesn't have the storage capacity. So these goods are going to have to sit somewhere for a while until you can effectively get them to the marketplace. And again, this is just, it's not unique to that country. There are numerous others. So it's, you're absolutely right in terms of storage capacity, increased container capacity, and so on. You're absolutely right.
If I could touch on the soft infrastructure piece, because I think that's critically important and something that we focus on. So in the era of constrained resources, we know that the cost of the infrastructure we need vastly exceeds capacity by anyone individually, private sector, public sector at all levels. So what we need to do is, and what we're working on, both with our federal partners, but also with our local partners, is breaking down the silos. And so it's a kind of another way of talking about collaboration, but let me put a maybe a finer point on it. So we know that the federal budget has been under tremendous pressure, and EDA is a very small part of the federal government. So what we look to do is really leverage the dollars that we're investing in. And our money is not free. It's competitive. It's merit-based. And it also requires a match starting at one-to-one. So there's already skin in the game from the local community. But that's not enough in these days with flat federal budget and even potentially declining federal budget, a declining federal budget that we've seen with sequestration in 2013 and looking ahead. We have to do more with existing resources. So what we're leading Commerce and EDA is better integration of the federal resources. And we've seen that, I think, with EDA and DRA's partnership, our partnership with labor, with the Department of Defense, even HUD, and also with USDA, and within Commerce itself, our work for better collaboration with ITA and our other Commerce partners. We are advancing an integrator approach, which will look at how we better execute and implement the federal dollars that are going into communities. There's about $17 billion every year in economic development federal investment that goes into communities every year, and I think we all know that can be very stovepiped. So one of the things that we're leading is an effort to better integrate that and leverage those existing dollars. Equally important is on the ground, breaking down the silos on the ground. And Greg mentioned this morning we had a presentation from GNO Inc. And it's interesting to look back, and the mayor talked about this and others in terms of parochialism, and how far this region has come in terms of breaking down the silos. And when we look across the country, you know, that's really the model. It's always saying who's not at the table that should be at the table, and how can the different municipalities work better together. And I think what we've seen as we've tried to advance this model is cities and counties are working together for the first time ever, and private sector, university, higher education partners are now at the table where they weren't before. That's going to be critically important, because even coming out of the Great Recession, we're still seeing state and local revenues at all-time lows and continued pressures on public budgets. So it's going to be important to continue following the model that I think you have been here in greater New Orleans and in southern part of Louisiana in terms of bringing the partners together in a more effective way. And one example of that is that greater New Orleans, I think of where kind of the nexus between what we're trying to do at the federal level and what the local level is doing is, just recently, Greater New Orleans and I think a pretty big part of Louisiana was designated an Investing in Manufacturing Communities Partnership community, an IMCP community. This is a new approach that the Obama administration, led by EDA and the Department of Commerce, to bring together upwards of 15 federal agencies in a way to provide that integrated funding and more synchronized funding, but also to encourage better collaboration and incentivize better collaboration across not only state and local government, but across the supply chain. So making sure that the federal, the private sector partners are at the table and looking at everything from infrastructure to the supply chain, to workforce training, really across the board to make sure that we're using funds from all different sources in a more effective manner. And so, there are only 24 IMCP communities. We've done two rounds of this designation. And as I mentioned, Greater New Orleans and Southern Louisiana has been designated as one of the 12 in the second round. And what that's going to enable this region to be able to do is not only use it as a branding and an additional imprimatur of the success at bringing the players together, but it's also going to enable easier access to federal resources, even at some agencies, preferential access to federal resources, and a much more coordinated approach. So each of these designated regions has a single point of contact with the federal government to make it easier to work with the agencies that are involved and to access the federal resources. But equally as important, it's showing that as a region, you've come together and brought the partners together, but constantly be asking who's not at the table that should be sustainably, not just pro forma, not just, you know, a one-off, but who's at the table for the long term? And are we following our comprehensive economic development plan for the long term that emphasizes the importance of trade, workforce development, infrastructure? That's going to be key.
If I could, I think, you know, just piggybacking here just for a second, you know, what we're talking about really exemplifies the practice of turning our risk into an opportunity. And I think that's what's so important about MRCTI as it relates to Delta Regional. And you may notice that much of what we've been talking about this morning is focused on the Mississippi's southern half or lower half. But there's actually a five-state corridor from Missouri to northern Minnesota that contributes to this region as well. And on September 15th, the mayors through MRCTI will release an economic profile of the Upper Mississippi River. And this will be the first Upper Mississippi River profile or economic profile that's been done since 1999. So again, another example of coming to get together in a collaborative effort to change and to sustain the change that we want to see. And since the Lower Mississippi River Conservation Committee published this economic development profile for the Delta in 2014. This will be the first time ever that we'll have a contemporary view of how all 2,500 miles of river contributes to the United States GDP. And our cities are stewards of one of the most important rivers. These are the cities along the Mississippi, the small municipalities that we keep talking about that myself and Mayor Copeland represent. And as cities along its banks, we have the largest presence on the waterway. Collectively, we do. So we have the most capacity to either guide the change and basically have something develop in a favorable way because of this change, or we have a lot to lose. So for that, this MRCTI organization is so important up and down the entire stretch of our river. So through our cities, we have jurisdictional boundaries, that's true, but the issues that we face do not. So this is why it's so important that we come together, small communities and large, to be able to focus on the change that we want to see. We fully support the work of DRA. I applaud Chairman Masingill for your efforts and stand ready to promote their mission along with MRCTI and any way that we can from the Gulf of Mexico to the headwaters of our Mississippi River. And I just want to say thank you again for allowing MRCTI to be a part of this panel this morning.
You're welcome, Mayor, and thank you. And real quickly, before we continue, Paul had to step out early to get to his board meeting, so he wanted everybody to know that he wasn't just bailing out. He had to get back over for a very important board meeting. We appreciate him taking so much time with us today. So we're talking infrastructure, soft infrastructure, physical infrastructure to help promote and expand trade and export. Are we finished with this question, or Craig?
You want to add anything to job it? With it. I'll set this one out.
Okay. Well, then one more question, and I'd like to turn to you all. And this question is really on the practical sense. You know, we've kind of been hitting it from a 30,000 feet view, but on a more kind of a laser specific. How do we engage better on this issue at the local level with existing small businesses, but how do we also bring in and focus on the inclusion of women and minority-owned businesses in the context of trade internationally? You know, what we're learning from the recovery effort here in New Orleans is that it has to be a all hands on deck. It has to be inclusive. Everybody has to have opportunity to have that upward mobility and creating greater middle class. So how does this issue of trade and export deal with that subject matter? Any particular thoughts on the practicality of how we engage?
Sure, I'll tackle it. Why not? Look, it's always the same, whether it's minority-owned or woman-owned or majority-owned. It's three simple things in my view: access, capital, and inclusion. What do I specifically mean by that? Well, one, you want to have access to the opportunities and know what they are. Two, you need capital. So there needs to be state assistance, federal assistance, local assistance to finance the opportunities that are available.
And then lastly, inclusion for some of the larger companies that have, shall we say, the economic breadth and ability to source trade opportunities. They need to include some of these smaller businesses. That's just my broader view. And I've seen the greatest impediment, I think, for any type of business is lack of knowledge in terms of what the opportunities are. So it is incumbent upon all of us to focus on making sure that every single type of business, in particular lower middle market businesses, which we focus on, know what's going on, know what's available. And that gets back to my point of strategic sourcing of opportunities for trade. That's what's critical, and that's what really needs to be done. Because the guy who has telecom equipment may need to know that, hey, there's a market for you in, say, Ghana, wherever it may be. It's access to information, having a clear way that these people can access this information.
Great point, Greg. You want to?
Yeah, for us, I would agree. But it's outreach.
Right.
Whether it's to, you know, partners, such as everyone here today, or to exporters or potential exporters. So that's really what our job is day to day, is being out in the field, meeting with the companies that are exporting, taking them to a new market, or meeting with companies that have the ability to be in the export field. So our performance measures are actually based on the success of everybody else in the room. So we reach out to you guys, want to, you know, work with you, because your win is our win. So that's kind of, it's an interesting approach, but I think it makes sense.
That could, Chris.
Yes, sir.
And I think this is important, that this room clearly understands the importance of trade to this part of the country. And we had a big win, obviously, in Trade Promotion Authority passing that the president pushed. We need trade agreements. We need the TPP and the TPA to get done. And we need all our elected representatives to know the importance, because in the TPP and in the TPA, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and getting confused with my acronyms. Bottom line is, when Greg talked about and Hank talked about access, you know, large companies have an army of people to navigate the barriers and red tape involved often with international trade that small and medium-sized companies don't have. And what's built into the trade agreements that are being negotiated now are specific measures and tools and processes and other things to help break down that red tape and those barriers to small and medium-sized businesses that want to export or want to export more. And I think that's critically important, that we get those passed, and the potential of New Orleans and really of the entire country from a trade and an economic growth perspective only increases as we reach the new markets that have largely gone untapped because of those barriers. So breaking down the barriers in the markets, but also helping clear the barriers that small and medium-sized businesses have, while building in the labor and environmental protections that I think all of us know is part of our values, that's built in. And so we need to keep that at the top of the agenda, and again, make sure that I can't formally tell you to call your senators and congressmen and elected officials, but let me just say that it's important that they know the importance of this.
So if I should happen to pull up the number, I should actually, just by chance.
Great point. Outreach, lack of knowledge. Your win is our win. I think that's actually a great way to kind of transition. And as we do that, just as a reminder to our panelists, because I want you to share how to get this information, Greg. Particularly, you, how do people, how do small businesses, how do they reach this information with the commercial service and ITA? This is being live streamed, too, so that's why I want you to go ahead and publicly say, how do they get to it? What's your website? How do they reach that technical assistance?
Yeah. First of all, the website's export.gov, so www.export.gov. But what's interesting is some statistics that some of you may now already know. More than 96% of the world's customers and approximately 80% of global purchasing power are outside of the United States. Those are pretty big numbers, right? So put another way, if you're only selling in the U.S., you're only reaching out to 4% of the opportunities that exist. That's not the best way to do business, I would think. So I would strongly urge you, wherever you're located, and if you're outside of the state of Indiana, we have offices across the country. So, you know, please reach out to our export assistance centers. You can get the contact information from me for any of our colleagues across the country. We're located in about 75 countries around the world, and that's probably the most important fact to you guys. We're there on the ground, so boots on the ground working for you. You know, we are there to help you find, as I mentioned earlier when I was speaking, partners in other countries. You know? So if you're like sitting here and you're saying, I really don't know anybody in South Africa or China or some other place, but you know what? You do. And you don't for me or one of my other colleagues. It's that simple. So it's a very close situation where you just have to reach out both ways, I guess it works, to your export assistance center and take advantage of the services that are there. We have a lot of free services for you, helping you figure out which markets are best, ways to take advantage of all the opportunities that exist, whether it's through a trade agreement or otherwise. Lots of training available, and we're going to have some training today, live case studies, so it's going to be interesting to hear from these experts. But yeah, work with your local export assistance center, work with your local district export council. Again, to remind you, those are the experts that are in business already exporting, so, and they're happy to share their knowledge with you to take advantage of it.
Thank you.
Could I have one quick
yes.
question? Matt, Greg, would you mind adding one other point for small businesses in terms of some of the federal support that's out there, like OPIC, Ex-Im Bank, Import-Export, and all these other institutions that actually guarantee trade, support trade, provide insurance? Because if I'm a small business, I'm very concerned about how much am I at risk if I get an investment to sell a bunch of, let's say, large-scale engines to South Africa, for instance. How am I protected? And in fact, the U.S. government has certain things in place to give you insurance against that, give you currency protection, risk protection, and so on.
I'll let the expert, trade expert, talk to that.
Well, and as you mentioned, Export-Import Bank, if you don't know, it's the hot issue right now in trade, and we want to make sure that they are reauthorized and they go forward. So it's an interesting situation, but with Export-Import Bank, as you mentioned, they have several services they offer. One is financing for certain types of exports so that they can compete against the foreign competition kind of in a toe-to-toe, so it's equal match. They also have things such as accounts receivable insurance. Now, what's one of the things you're most concerned about when you're selling overseas? Make sure you get paid. Because you can sell all day, but if you don't get paid, you don't care, right? So Export-Import Bank, we'd like to see them continue to be in business. Trade agreements he's already touched on, so I won't reiterate too much there. But, Crystal's here. She's in the back. She's already raised her hand once, but I'm going to ask her to do that again. You know, take the time. There's going to be a break here. And give her your card. She'll be happy to come out and speak to you at your place of business and hear all about what you're doing and open some new markets for you, I hope.
And also, there's also Overseas Private Investment Corporation, OPIC, which provides insurance, financing, loans, et cetera, which is available. I know because we set up a business in Africa to use the fund, particularly useful organization. And, I don't think it has the continuation risk that the import export.
Great information, and I know SBA also provides some assistance too. How do people, Michael, get to SBA's information?
Well, we actually have the regional IT loan manager here with us today.
Excellent.
Greg from Harley, so I'll let him talk about it.
How do they get a hold of you?
I'm actually, in theory, co-located with the UCAC, U.S. Exposure.
Perfect.
So my partners, just like we talked about, are people like Greg or the director, along with Chris, and just so that you know, the small business does provide guarantee to our local lenders, our lender, in order that they can support export trade, and that can be everything from working capital or account to equipment if you're having to add equipment, change out your equipment, or be more or to reach a market that you haven't, and even for real estate, to either purchase a building or restructure your building in some way in order to be able to take on exporting. But you're out there as an instant that guarantees the loan up to $5 million. And we'll have more on that in the next panel.
Excellent. EDA.gov, export.gov, SBA.gov, DRA.gov, lots of resources out there.
Can I add www?
Of course.
www.mrcti.org, Mississippi River Cities and Towns Initiative, if I could add that as well.
Perfect, absolutely. Okay, question. Yes,
to right the feedback on your point, I mean, there are about 20 federal agencies that are a part of this whole support network for those who are either interested in finding out about exporting or are actively exporting. Mentioned many of them here, and of course, the location being one, USDA even, one that's supporting exporting. We have SUSA here, and many, many others, but there are so many aspects of support. I mean, that sometimes is a challenge, is to figure out which entity you need to be in touch with or access in order to figure out the market or get it from me. That's a challenge. But there are many of us that are out there and use the app. Let's get help sort through those things and kind of help guiding anyone through this network of federal agencies and help put you in touch with those.
Perfect, thank you. There is a lot of information, and I think Hank, you made a great point. It is a really a lack of knowledge or just knowing the information is there, which is why we've teamed up with our federal partners to make sure businesses in the Delta region know this information is there and how to access it. They don't know how to get there, then we sure in the heck can't expect them to take that first next step or to take the next step to increase their own capacity.
There's an analogy that my father used to say. I can tell you how to tie your shoes, or I can actually show you. So it's better if I show you so that you actually learn. I think that is really true in this case. Again, I go back to it's our obligation, really, to show those out there. There is all this stuff available.
Great point. Questions from you all? Yes, ma'am. You want to state your name and where you're from and who you represent?
I'm glad to. My name is Dolores Brewer, and I'm from the City of Valley Food. I'm the director of planning in that community, and I know we're not on the Mississippi River, but my question is, if you touch on what kind of collaboration communities that are not along the Mississippi River, but are along, in our case, along the river, how we can have it, how the impact can be for these communities, in addition to those along the Mississippi River, because we have lots of small businesses in central Louisiana, and that's why we came to that. We wanted to find out what we can do and how we can be a part, even though we're not on this.
Fair point. Anybody want to tackle that first?
Mayor, you want
to? You know, I would say what is the closest city to Alexandria that's on the Mississippi? And I would collaborate with that. What is that city? What is the city? I mean, I would collaborate with that city, my closest neighbor. I would collaborate with my closest neighbor, and I would see what do you have? What is the investment in your community that could add to the regional, you know, fix or the regional opportunity for Baton Rouge? Is it housing? Is it, you know, a school system? Is it a smaller walking communities? Is it more quality of life with regard to living space as it relates to a bigger city? For Gretna, although we are a Mississippi River city, that's what it is for us. I mean, the reality is we have to look at what we bring to the table to assist the regional development of New Orleans. So that would be my suggestion, would be to meet and collaborate with the Mississippi city that's closest to you.
I think the thing I would also piggyback on that is, as Greg was talking about, these regional export councils is a good way to plug in, and quite frankly, DRA is a platform to plug in too. Our whole focus is dealing with economic development from a regional perspective. It's not just about one political subdivision.
know, the reality is that businesses, they don't care about city limits. They don't care about parish limits, police jury districts or county districts, depending on where you're from. They land where they can make money and create more jobs. And the more that we can tackle these issues from a regional perspective, the more we're going to grow together and be stronger. So I appreciate you being here. It's a great, great question.
And I would just add, yep. A colleague of mine in the back there, Chris Rice.
So raise your hand, Chris.
We, EDA, we divide the country into six regions that we service out of six regional offices, and Louisiana is serviced out of our Austin, Texas regional office. But we have personnel specifically assigned to work with communities like yours, and actually we're going to be moving to have an economic development representative, our representative just retired who covered Louisiana, and we're going to be replacing that position in the near future. But in terms of working with EDA, you know, I encourage you to connect with Chris and see how the Austin Regional Office can help connect you as well.
Mayor?
We're working to get the town to be. Because they pay industry failure, need to ship and receive goods. They're going to work with the county port to be able to short this by my to be able
to. Great suggestion, Mayor. Good point. Other questions?
Yes, sir.
When we talk about
tell us who you are.
No, I'm sorry. Steve Wyndham with the Lieutenant Governor's Office.
Oh, great. Thank you for being here. No,
absolutely. Thank you guys for being here. When we talk about things that should be done, when the small businessman comes in there, what are the biggest hurdles that he has to recognize? How does he overcome this? I mean, if money, it's, you know, risk tolerance.
Great.
I'm afraid that I could lose my house or I could lose this. How do we get them past that hurdle to get them to the other side so that they can succeed?
Question.
I know in our business, we're supporting customers all on day small business owners, perhaps haven't really had a whole lot of experience in international trade. We spend a lot of time counseling and consulting. And I think the first thing is, you know, if you can move one container, you can move that. And I think it's basically that information that we talked about, access to all the great resources that we talk about. But also the immediate contact generally for a small business looking to start international trade. They're looking for a broker or a forwarder who can coach and counsel them. They're licensed. They have the knowledge. They have the information. And that's my support. Anyway, good start.
Good. Can I add a couple quick points? One of which, one thing to focus on is risk. And that's what her organization, some of the organizations here do, is help them assess the risk of. As you know, anytime you expand your business, there is risk. You expand beyond our markets, there is risk. And a lot of folks want to get into import-export, you know. But what does this really mean? And then secondly, capacity. Do you realistically have the capacity to expand if there is a larger market product? Helping them understand the risk. Of course, if those line up, then you move on to capital and so on.
And just, yes, sir. Just to kind of tag on to what Hank was saying, but from the opposite side is with risk, what comes? Opportunity, right? And so that's kind of what we're about, is trying to help you weigh that, where your opportunities are and where the risks are as well. You know, these services are free, most of them. We do have four fee services as well. We'll get into that some of that this afternoon. But take advantage of them. And just real quick to go back to your point, I want to thank you again for coming. I appreciate you for being proactive. And, you know, what can you do from our viewpoint, that reaching out? You're doing it this way, so what I'd ask you to do is help me reach out. So if you have a newsletter or whatever, you're going to be my multiplier. You're going to help me to show that company in your hometown. You talk to Greg or, you know, Crystal, are you aware of the services? And that's what I'm going to really rely on everybody here to help.
That's a great one. One other question. Well, super. Let me just say to the panel, Hank, Director, thank you, Mr. Secretary, Mayor, Donna, and of course, Paul, thank you all very much for
engaging with us on this issue. We do believe that expanding the capacity for international trade and export at the local, regional level is important. That's a very significant step forward in economic development strategies, even in rural America. So we're going to continue to engage in this. We're excited about the partnerships we announced today, and we appreciate you all listening. DRA.gov, please follow us on Facebook and Twitter, and we'd love to engage with you. Please call on us. 501-772-9686 is my cell number. Please call on me anytime. We want to get you connected. This is very important. We believe in what we're doing here, and we appreciate the success. And congratulations to New Orleans and GNO Inc. for all your successes and the great work still yet to come. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
We're going to take a 5-minute break, and then we're going to go into the workshop for businesses, the more technical pieces.
Oh,
so 5-minute break is to use the bathroom and reconvene.
Yes. don't have PowerPoints or any flashy materials, but what we do have, you're going to hear some great information from these guys, and we want this to be conversational, so we're going to ask you all to be part of this presentation. So I'll depend on you to make this work really well for us today. First of all, I want to thank all of our panelists. I'm going to let them introduce themselves, and particularly thank you to Robert for being our live case study. He's going to talk about his experience with exporting. To get started, Reg, go ahead.
Good morning, still. I'm Reginald Harley. I'm with the U.S. Small Business Administration. I'm a regional manager for the Office of International Trade, covering Mississippi, Arkansas, Louisiana, and the Gulf Coast of Texas.
Bob Weta, DSC Dredge. We're a dredge manufacturer with our corporate offices out of Reserve, Louisiana, and we manufacture mostly cutter suction dredges and small sizes being transportable on one truck up to dredges that take 30 trucks. Currently exporting to 45 countries and enjoying it.
Hello, everybody. I'm Nellie Smith. I'm with Whitney Bank, and I'm with the International Department. I manage the International for all of Whitney and Hancock. We're in five states, in Florida, Mississippi, and Alabama. We are Hancock Bank. And in New Orleans, in Louisiana and Texas, we're Whitney Bank. But we're still one organization. And we're pretty much the only bank in this area that has an international department here in New Orleans. And our international department is housed with professionals with 20 and 30 years experience. So we're there if you need us.
Hi, I'm Christy App. I'm Vice President of Business Development and Customer Service for J.W. Allen & Company. We're a New Orleans-based freight forwarder and customs broker who specializes in global logistics. We've been around in New Orleans since 1932. We were talking, had a little pre-meeting before this, and it's I always tell people I love this business. I love exporting, importing, all the change that comes along with it, all the challenges. So if you're new to it or getting involved in or looking to grow into it, you're looking to get into a great area of business.
Great. Thanks, everyone. And again, we're going to rely on you guys to help add to the conversation. I ask you to keep your questions or comments as targeted as possible to the situation at hand. But please don't hesitate to raise your hand at any time or jump in. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Robert.
Okay, I was basically tasked with coming up with a handful of stories that were either success stories, challenge stories, some things to be aware of as an exporter. And I chose some ones that I think could probably help everyone, and actually with this panel, some feedback to me will help me in the future as well. We signed at that time in our corporate career, we signed the largest contract we ever had with the company in Bangladesh, which is honestly a tough country to deal with, first of all, from a negotiating side. But once you do business with them, you're friends forever. Part of the contract required us to, which we didn't know, let me back up a little bit. We asked for advance payments. Our equipment can take up to 18 to 20 months to manufacture. So rather large dollars we're talking here. So we work off of progress payments. We did not realize their central bank had rules on progress payments had to be backed by a standby LC from our side, and we didn't have that factored into our pricing structure. And the customer said, oh, well. What that does is that digs into your profit margin, and that's just the lesson learned there would be if you're exporting to a country, be sure of their banking requirements if you're going to have advanced payments to make sure you're pricing it right. A second one, and this applies to all contracts, is to make sure you understand the INCO terms. If you can sell Ex Works, which means basically you guys come pick it up from my facility, and that's when the risk changes hands, that's the best way to do it. You're lucky if you get to do it that way. It doesn't happen all the time, but that would be the way I would say to do it. My experience with this and my story on this is probably the worst way is DDP, Incoterms. And if anyone needs Incoterm, you can just search it on Google or whatever. You'll have a great explanation of Incoterms 2010 of what all the terms mean. DDP basically puts all the responsibility on the exporter, including clearing customs, paying all duties, tariffs. In this instance, we were exporting to Canada. We were not licensed to do business and or didn't have an agency in Canada, so we were kind of stuck with the terms of now what do we do, because we have to pay the taxes. If we collect them, how do we pay them? We worked closely with our partner, the company we're selling to, which was Shell Canada at that point, changed it to a DAP term, which means delivered at place. Basically, all it does is take away the tariffs and puts it back on the buyer. Luckily, this was an exempt sale because of our trade relations and the commodity that we sell. Again, on the Incoterms, another thing is to don't get confused with an Incoterm and actually an acceptance or delivery. They're two totally different things. An Incoterm defines basically the terms of shipment, and it determines who's responsible for what, but that doesn't mean the client actually accepted it or accepted delivery of your products. So while an Incoterm needs to be clearly defined from an acceptance or a delivery standpoint. Let's see.
A couple of things. I'll just jump in and kind of go back to the first example, because I hit on a lot of different issues there that I think that would be interesting to focus on. First of all, 18 to 20 months to manufacture the product. That's a long window from, okay, this is when we're going to get a contract and figure out what we're going to charge and all of that and make money 18 to 20 months later. So I'm sure there's some things that, you know, he's run into besides what he's already shared with us, but something to think about. I'm sure some of you all have similar situations. I'd be curious to hear them. That's one thing. And then, you know, with the what's in a contract, we don't give legal advice. We're not allowed to. We can give factual advice. So if it's a law, it's a law. And, you know, if it should be in a contract or shouldn't be, we can tell you those types of things. A lot, and this is, again, all free information that we can provide you through our colleagues on the ground. The other thing is, you've got experts in the banking industry and, you know, and the shipping industry for all of these issues. So I'd be curious to kind of have them weigh in on some of the concerns with having such a long window, you know, of from start to finish.
Well, I can't address the long window, but what I can address is the bond that you talked about. We get that all the time. There are bonds that you have to put up. Was that like an advance payment bond you had to put?
Something equivalent in the form of an LC, yeah.
So yeah, when you're exporting to a lot of foreign countries, they do want bonds to be put up there. And most banks, U.S. banks, cannot issue a local bond in a foreign country. So you have to come to your bank, and that bank has to find a local bank for you in that country to issue the bond. And keep in mind that it's not something that could be done in a day or two. It takes a while to do with your banker. It costs money, like you said, and it involves two banks, so there's two banks fees. So all of that lesson learned is you want to talk to your banker before and your freight forwarder before you agree to any contract or sign any contract, so that you can know what the fees are and what the costs are going to be to put into that, because these advance payment bonds or bid bonds or performance bonds can be very expensive to get issued. So we want to mention.
Yeah, if I could mention too, though, that the good news as it relates to the standby letter of credit, if you have to have that in place, if you're looking at it from the vantage point of the maybe having a line of credit already that you're working with, usually you have to do that at a dollar for dollar coverage on it. This is an ad for SBA. If that is an SBA guarantee loan that you're using, EWCP. Then it doesn't have to be dollar for dollar. All you need is 25% of your of the amount of the bond to be placed or to set aside, so that you're not having as collateral, so that you're not having to use up as much of your working capital
in order to have that standby put in place.
And over a period of time like that, too, you have to, from a shipping perspective, you also have to take into consideration, especially on large projects, but even for a small shipment where you don't have, a ton of capital to swing either way, is you have to understand the volatility of the freight market. So, you know, your shipping cost August 1st, 2015 could be drastically different in March of 2017. There's a volatility in the bunker fuel, which is the fuel that drives the ship. There's a volatility of the intermodal freight market, which drives the trucks, the trains. Depending on whether it's, the price of oil, is it going to be $200 a container, or is it going to be $700 a container? It can vary that much. So you have to be sure to work into your sales contract, I'm sure, percentage swings to cover any differentiations in freight.
Yeah, and what we typically do is if we're required to include freight, we will put an estimate, very clearly state that it's an estimate and that to be billed at actual cost. And typically the buyer doesn't look at it. He sees, wow, look at this nice little low freight amount here, but if you cover yourself that way, you cover yourself.
And that's a key too. I'm sorry.
Sorry.
Is especially using your sales contract. Like your sales contract, besides your income terms and your letter of credit, your sales contract and international transaction will cover everything. It'll cover, deliverance. It'll cover transfer of ownership. Where title transfers. I encourage people, and your sales contract doesn't have to be this huge, long legal document. It could be your performer invoice with everything detailed out, and if it's a small shipment. But, make sure you dot your I's and cross your T's with all the intangibles in your contract.
Sir?
So as we're going to help people, small business and such, are there financial models that show, something should be this percentage, shipping should be approximately 5%, 10%. There's something that the small businessman and the small businesswoman can look at and say, okay, I can go forward with this, but I understand.
From my market, the shipping market doesn't make a lot of sense. For example, for me, to ship a dry 40-foot container from one of my customers from the port of New Orleans to the port of Santo Tomas in Guatemala can maybe be, let's just say $2,000. To get a container right now from the port of New Orleans via ramp over the West Coast to Shanghai could be $1,800. So it's hard to tell people when you're based off of a model. The shipping market's all about supply and demand. How many carriers you have in the market? What's the space like? So a lot of times, you look at it, it's like, you look at Central America, and like, this is going to be great. I'll get great shipping costs. You probably get more competitive rates going to Asia and Europe than you would going to a place that's closer. And the reason why is there's not as many ocean carriers that feed into, these areas that are geographically closer to us. So to answer your question, it's hard to, make a sort of algorithm or a formula to project shipping costs when they don't really follow any sort of predictable rule and what you would look at, whether it's geography or, a lot of times the rates can swing based upon how much space a carrier has in their vessel. And so that's kind of hard to pin down without really, it's really knowing the market and looking at it and judging it. So there's not really a set percentage you can go off of.
I'll jump in on that one. As she says, it's really knowing the market. And I think to your point as well, because she's right, it's going to be different for every country and every product. It's there's no formulaic thing. However, in what we call a basic guide to exporting, we have a worksheet where we try to make sure that you've thought of everything that you might run into. So it lists everything that, value-added taxes and all these tariffs and so forth, that hopefully you will look into as the exporter and make sure that you've covered yourself for make sure that you're going to be profitable at the end of the day.
We rate average between 5 and 10% of the product that we're selling will be freight, and that's going to swing 3 to 12, depending on where you go and how big it is. But, 5 to 10 for my product is a safe estimate.
Sure.
Some of the advice we get is on the custom investment, the custom product, the product bond, less risk. But we would commonly give advice that we're better off controlling the freight until it gets there for the length. So I'm kind of wondering how your experience with this one should be able to do that. As most of the time you have to take the document, put it in the bank, and say, oh, this is an Indian, so then page board, deliver the product.
And I think that's different. It's going to be, she's probably going to be the expert on that, but it's going to be different for every product and every country. And it's industry by industry. Most time you're going to find that somebody, they're meeting the middle, you know, because you've got the extreme that, you know, as you mentioned, you pick up at my door or I take it to your door. That doesn't happen very often. Yeah, so it's usually somewhere in the middle. But now,
yeah, well, that is a concern with Ex-Works because I always wonder what the freight, you know, in a letter of credit, you're right. You don't get paid if your documents are not in order. So once they've picked up those goods from you, basically you've given up the goods. So if you have a discrepancy on that letter of credit, that when it comes in, that you really have to know that buyer that you're working with. You do your due diligence on him, and you discuss that beforehand. Because banks will call discrepancies if it's not a misspelled word, but if it's an inconsistency between documents. It's not a huge discrepancy. You're not shipping late or but we can call a discrepancy, and then you're out that money. So it all depends on that buyer. You better know that buyer, because once you give those goods up, they're gone, and the discrepancy will be there. The bank that owns those documents, once we send those documents on, they have to get to that buyer, and that buyer has to give permission to waive those discrepancies. So you are stuck then. So you better know your buyer really, really well.
But is that then vote for having
for me, yes. For my, in my opinion, I'm very nervous when I see Ex-Works. But is there a way with the shipping company for them to?
No.
I mean, they've already picked up the goods; it's theirs.
We highly discourage when we talk to exporters who, you know, letters of credit are a whole other animal there. But we highly discourage exporters from using Ex-Works on a letter of credit.
I agree.
One, because you know, the whole means of getting paid by a letter of credit is turning in letter of credit compliant documents to a bank to get your money. So the moment you do Ex-Works, you're giving your customer in some foreign country control over your means of payment. Because with Ex-Works, you're not doing the shipping documents. You're not making any sort of document that will then allow you to be paid. So we highly discourage Ex-Works. I think you can get to the point where FOB, where you can maybe control the ocean bill of lading, and then, which means you only have to get it to the port of sailing. But you have to know, you know, like you were talking about earlier, knowing where your risk transfers. And for a lot of people, Ex-Works is great when you have customers that have the ability and the relationships from their foreign country to come into the United States and have a partnership that would allow them to pick up a dredge that can be broken down almost into 55 shipments, you know, like you said, that big, that they have that, because, I mean, they're obviously buying a very expensive piece of equipment, so they have the relationships and that. But when you come into people with, maybe it's a small company overseas looking to buy a U.S. good, they may not have those relationships set up. So it's, you know, you'll have to look at it. It's like, am I going to lose the sale, or am I going to take the risk and form a partnership with people in the U.S., you know, whether it's a forwarder or a shipping company or a trucker, and say, all right, I can, you know, I'm going to do my due diligence, I'm going to get it together. And that's how you grow your business, is by learning about the market, learning what it takes to move beyond Ex-Works and maybe go to CFR. And I know it sounds like you hear so many, you know, these CFR, DDP, all this. It's like, it's living alphabet soup, but they all mean something. So it's just, you know, you have to take a bit more risk sometimes. But also at the time to that, not only to maybe be able to gain the sale, but at the same time too, you know, I'm going to go to you because you all do a lot of the oil and gas. You know, a lot of times for an export control perspective, you know, depending on where your goods are going, and same thing with Billy in the back, you know, is when you're dealing in the oil and gas field, in oil and gas services, a lot of times you're going to markets, and you need to, per the U.S. government, you know, the exporter has a responsibility to make sure that they're applying, you know, whether you're shipping Ex Works or DDP, you know, you have to be sure that you're complying with all U.S. laws and regulations for exports, that you're shipping and dealing with people that can receive goods from the United States, that your good isn't dual use, and maybe it's, you know, it's an electric panel that goes on a dredge, but also, you know, with a small tweak, it can be put on a nuclear facility. So, you know, a lot of times if you pick an Ex Works Incoterms on a dual use good, you know, you're losing a little bit of your control there too.
Yeah.
But
so there's not a perfect answer, I think, with what you're hearing.
Get paid in advance, 100%.
That's all. Cash in advance is always a good thing.
Or what you can do is you can discuss with the buyer and not do a commercial letter of credit. So you ship an open account. Again, you have to know your buyer. Your buyer has to know you. There has to be some trust. And get a standby letter of credit just to stand by. So you ship, you deliver the goods to them, they get it. You, in your contract, you write in how many days they have to pay you, if it's 30 days, 20 days, whatever. And if they don't, then you can draw under that standby letter of credit by just presenting a statement that says, we certify that these things have to happen. We've shipped. Here's a copy of the shipping document. We've presented our invoice. We agreed to 30 days. 30 days have elapsed. Payment has not been made. And you draw on that standby. We see that more. That's called like a commercial standby. It just is there in case they don't pay.
And keep in mind, sometimes you may want these terms, but the buyer is such a large presence, like say Saudi Aramco, for instance, maybe they're going to tell you exactly what it's going to be. You don't tell them what you're going to want because they're not interested. So you don't always have a choice. Regardless, you've got experts to go to, you know, in any instance, you know, across the, and that's what they're here for.
You can do these.
One of the things I found out while working on a LC in Nigeria, we had a corresponding bank, the nightmare we had, is City Bank in Miami. And they would reject the letter of credit because we didn't have a capital A USA or something along like that, or didn't have a period on it. They did this like three times, and we're getting close to the end of the life of the LLC. And so we started telling them, we're going to sue Citibank because you're fixing the cost of the $500 million sale. We didn't realize that if the customer accepts it like it is, they'll go through like it is. That's why they wanted to tell us. But why don't they tell us that thing again? And it saved a lot of them. Once you got letters from the customers, they get a lot of stuff to all that like it is. Everything was okay. But it almost cost us a sale.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the larger banks are, and not to discredit any large banks, but I think a lot of the larger banks, you know, your letter, it's all a profit center, ultimately. But I think a lot of times...
Discrepancy charges.
From us working with, I mean, we've used, you know, Whitney a lot, and it's, and you, you know, you deal with people downtown, and you can talk to them, and so it's, you know, you're not talking to a service center somewhere else.
Yeah. Ma'am.
This lady had random.
Go ahead.
Like you were mentioning, there is a sample document that you can check for exporting.
Yes. It's called a basic guide to exporting, and it's on our website. There's a link to it. The book, it's a book, and I think it's 10 chapters, maybe. I can't remember, but each chapter is on a specific topic, like pricing, etc. Yeah, I think it's the link to it because I think it's on ICC's website, if I remember correctly. Do you guys remember?
The BIS hasn't.
Yeah, but the link's going to be on export.gov for sure.
Guide for exporting.
I've heard so much about FedEx Global Delivery. One of the panel participants talk about if what they're doing is legal, or is that what you mean by open panel? Because my shipment probably could go by FedEx if I had a contact in a place, but I'm not sure if doing that is legal or not.
Go ahead.
I think ultimately FedEx Global is a means to get your cargo from one place to another. The legality first lies with who you're selling to, where you're shipping your products to, And can you sell and ship your products to those places? FedEx Global is the only thing you'll be paying them on open account for is to really get your, you know, I don't, as far as I'm aware, FedEx Global didn't open a trading company, so they're not actually going to be paying for your goods or arranging for, you know, a sale. The only thing FedEx, and I think it's FedEx Trade Networks, is FedEx's border side. But they just move it. So if you, you know, if you apply for credit with FedEx and you want to air freight a box from here to Antwerp, then it's as long as you follow what you're supposed to do as a shipper from the export side, there's nothing wrong with using FedEx. But it's at the same time, you know, basically in that instance, FedEx is your freight forwarder. That's what they are. So FedEx Global is your freight forwarder.
But you're still responsible. You're the exporter.
Yeah.
You're still responsible to make sure you've done everything right, as she mentioned very early on, who you're selling to, what's your product, does it have requirements of, you know, licensing and so forth. That's not really their responsibility per se. It ultimately is going to come back to you. I don't know what the product is. I don't think you mentioned, but
I don't have anything definite in mind. I've got either bakery products or
fairly.
The bakery we have time limits on it, so I probably won't go guarantee there. But the artwork, let's see.
Right.
Well, one of the things you should think about, though, right now, since it's early, is compliance. You know, you said, is it legal? It's not that it's not legal, but there are certain countries and certain individuals that you cannot do business with. So you have to make sure before you even start talking to anybody, if they email you and they say, hey, you have these bakery products to sell, I'd like to buy from you. There are certain websites that you need to go to, like the Office of Foreign Assets Control, that you must put that name in and check it before you even start talking to these people.
I saw something like that. It looked at some of the additives to bakery products that were okay in the United States by the FDA, but foreign countries, some of them banned it.
And that's a different issue, though.
That's a little different
because she's talking about U.S. laws, and that's talking about the foreign country's laws.
What I'm talking about is as per the United States laws, there are certain countries, like Cuba right now, that you cannot do business with without certain licenses. So you have to make sure that you know that that country is not on the OFAC list. A great site for you to go to when you're starting to export is the BIS, the Bureau of Industry and Security, and I think they have that same link to the export.gov. Yeah. They have training in there. They have videos that you can do, online training. Everything is free. Everything you want to know about exporting is there. There's an export portal. When you go in there, there's like maybe 15 site little buttons that you can go into. It tells you everything you need to know about exporting. But please remember, if you don't remember anything else from today, remember that you must go to OFAC, O-F-A-C, Office of Foreign Assets Control, and check the name of the person that's looking to buy those goods from you before you even start saying you're going to sell to them.
And I'll just call on my colleague Marisol, because Marisol is in charge, if you'll want to stand up. If you were here earlier, you heard us talk about the District Export Councils. Marisol works for the District Export Council here locally, and she's in charge of all the training we kind of do. She works with us on, and she put this together, not me, and did a great job, by the way, so thank you. But for all topics that you might want to get more detailed information in, because this was meant to be conversational to kind of throw out a lot of ideas for you to think about, but if you want to dive into a topic, she can let you know when they're going to have a training on that specific issue. Or it sounds like to me, you're really more of an exporting 101, you know. So I think you would want to get with Marisol and kind of find out when those are coming up.
Well, actually, right. Because I need to figure out how to cost my product. And I need to know if I'm going to store it at Hecht or Masingill or Landrieu or Thompson or Hecht. Mm-hmm. And then how much space costs. But from the earlier panel discussion, that sounds like
I asked about
You can't get the payment?
Yes.
If it's confirmed, then then the confirming bank then steps into the shoes of the issuing bank. So you're no longer dealing with the bank in Tunisia. You're now dealing with the bank in the U.S. But you still have to present documents that are in compliance to the letter of credit, because if you do present them with a discrepancy, then the confirming bank's confirmation pretty much goes away too. So. Oh. And what's that condition? Oh, really? So all discrepant documents will be accepted? Yeah. Well, that's a good thing. I mean, you can put that in, but usually they would be very specific, because you can't say all discrepancies are going to be accepted. But. Right. That's a good idea. Expiry date. Correct. Right. That's a good idea. But just to let you know where we come up with the discrepancies, it's not that we just look for discrepancies and call it. I do believe maybe some of the larger banks may do that. But there's documents that we have to follow. You know, the UCP, which is Uniform Customs and Practice 600, that is what we have to follow. That's the Bible. Those letters of credit are issued subject to that. So whatever the UCP says that the documents must have or must be consistent, we have to check the documents in accordance with that. Now, I know years ago they would stop you for a period or a capital. The rules have changed, and it doesn't allow you to stop documents for if it's not capital or if it's LTD as opposed to limited spelled out. It's gotten much better. So.
But that's there for you all. That's to protect both parties.
Correct.
You know, it's not to help the bank
out. It's
not
for the bank. It's
there to make sure you're going to, you know, get what you're expecting.
Buyer and seller, exactly.
And don't be afraid of discrepancies, because in my career, I don't think I've ever had an LC go through the first time without having a discrepancy. It just happens.
You're right. 80% of documents are presented with discrepancies. And then you have the option that you can fix them, but some of them you can't fix, like the bills of lading, sometimes you can't fix those. But I've been doing this for a very long time, and in all my years that I've been doing it, I've only seen one set of documents that was refused by the buyer because the buyer wanted to get out of the sale. So even when you send the documents with discrepancies, you know your buyer, you've had a relationship with them, they're going to accept those discrepancies. So. Right, if it's expiry date already gone or latest shipment date, then they may not, right? But for I'm talking about just little, smaller discrepancies, not major. Right. That's a very good idea to put that in the LC. If your buyer allows you to do that, that's a good thing.
Yes, sir.
Question for Bob. So can I assume that all these dredges are sold locally?
Yes. Yep.
Okay. So then when y'all decided to go overseas, I mean, how did you first get hooked up with anybody, a potential buyer? What was it that allowed you to make that leap?
I call it dumb luck. All right. So, I mean, we would advertise in U.S. magazines, and there's a lot of foreign buyers that want U.S. products, and they come here and they pick up that magazine and they see your ad. What's helped drive it recently, or in the past 10, 15 years, is the internet. I mean, that's your global highway right there.